So we are still very much in recovery process. Debris is probably the biggest thing that that we're seeing now. That's kind of the biggest part of our operation, is the debris management. So the contractors have been on, been active for a little over a week now. When I talked to them on Saturday, they'd already picked up 200,000 cubic yards. So that's probably, a little more than a tenth of what we got, though. I mean, so they've still got a long way to go. One of the big things we're seeing is people still piling stuff on the on top of the lines and having mixed debris. So, it's not for lack of messaging, because I know Megan has pushed it out on our Facebook page multiple times. But if you do get calls, the most likely thing, if the crews come through and miss a pile, it's because there's stuff mixed in there, or they've got lines tangled in there where people have stacked it. So we need their help with kind of following the guidance we've given to speed up the recovery process. We are along those lines. I started this weekend pushing to FEMA to file an expedited project so that we can hopefully get some of our, they have a process that will allow us to get at least half of the funding based on the estimate up front. So that eases some of the burden. It's still going to take, I was telling the chairman this morning, so we did the same thing during Hurricane Idalia, and we're still waiting to get the second half of the funding. So it's been 13 months, so it's not going to cure all our ills, but it will help at least get some of that money up front. FEMA is still, also went and visited, as late as yesterday, went to the disaster recovery center that's at the old church on North Forest Street Extension. They're still seeing 150 plus people a day come through. And typically what the DRC manager says, typically they'll see a huge spike, which is what we're getting now. It'll wane off a little bit, and then as people start coming in and need to file appeals, we'll have another wave. So they plan to be here for a while. Also working with them to, in addition to that one physical location, they do have a, what they call a DSA, Disaster Survivor Assistance Team, that's going out in the streets, kind of walking, and we're gonna do some things to kind of set up some little temporary, like mobile sites that people can go to in other areas of the community. We just wanna make sure that everybody that needs to speak to FEMA has an opportunity and has access. So we're still working with them on that. The shelter is still open. As of yesterday, we still had four people in the shelter. So right now it's at Bethany Baptist Church, but we're hopeful that in the next couple of days that we can work with Red Cross and get those people transitioned to something a little more suitable than just a cottage shelter. But again, we're working through their processes on that, trying to support them the best we can. What else do you want to
know? Can you clarify on the contaminated debris when you said that they may have skipped some of that? If it's contaminated, does that mean that it gets left there, or are we just handling it in a different manner?
So if they've mixed debris in there, then it's their responsibility. I mean, we'll know that. We'll let them know that, hey, this is why yours didn't get picked up. And then it's their responsibility. They've got to go separate it. Now, the C&D, we call it, the sheetrock, carpeting, whatever else is, furniture that's mixed in there, they have to work with their private waste hauler to get rid of that or haul it off themselves. But we're going to make multiple passes. So it's not a one and you're done. We come by and didn't get it, we're not coming back. I mean, because there's some people that have so much debris that they can't get it all to the road in one shot. So we'll make multiple passes. our goal is a lofty goal, but we're working with the contractor, and we believe that we can hopefully get it all picked up within 90 days, have to be done by Christmas. That's not a promise, that's just a goal. And they're bringing in as many resources as they can. I think just in the unincorporated areas, and this doesn't count the small cities and City of Valdosta, just our part of the contract, when I look at the report, I believe we have 100 trucks that they're running just in the unincorporated area. So they're making a huge push to get this picked up as quickly as humanly possible.
And with regards to the contamination as well, Public Works has, or not Public Works, but Code Enforcement has door hangers in their trucks. So either if we get a call from the hauler saying we've got some locations that are contaminated, we have someone go in and leave a door hanger, or if they're right across the county and they see some area that they know is not going to be picked up because of contamination, we're leaving a door hanger to go ahead and let people know that they need to get that CND out. So we've been really proactive there. We're running the same regulatory that we started in the very beginning as far as permits and inspections go. And then I think the one update that I have not given you all regarding that is we had some people who had permits that were in process, and then a tree fell on whatever they were trying to remodel or upgrade or whatever the case may be. So if for some reason that permit is no longer needed, then we are refunding those permit costs so that they can figure out what direction they want to go in, and then they can start the process on their permit.
I would also add, commissioners, you may get called, because I know I have gotten a few calls and I've had to explain the process. But again, neither the haulers, the debris removal contractors, or the county can go onto private property and remove that debris. That debris has to be at the curb site of a public road so that it can be picked up. So that's extremely important. I've had a few calls on that issue as well. Folks want us to come in on private property, go down the road to get debris, and we just can't do that. So I totally make that real quick.
We have plenty of volunteer groups in town now. One thing that a lesson learned from Adalia, there were people calling 3 and 4 months after the storm, calling emergency management and saying, hey, can I get somebody to come help me? Well, by that time, everybody, all the volunteer groups had finished all their work orders and were gone. So now is the time. We have two ways that they can report. Crisis cleanup, I don't remember the other number off the top of my head. I know Megan, again, has posted it numerous times on our Facebook page. And also Samaritan's Purse has a number that you can call directly to Samaritan's Purse, and they'll come out. Samaritan's Purse has told me that they expect to be here after the first of the year. So that's one of the things. There'll be people that say, well, I'm waiting on Samaritan's Purse to come move my debris. We have a process. We're not going to penalize people for the fact that Samaritan's Purse or another volunteer group could get to them. What we'll do is once we've cut off the deadline, establish a deadline for people to get stuff to the curb, we'll work directly with Samaritan's Purse and the other volunteer groups, and they'll send us a list. These are the addresses that they move the stuff to, and if we can verify that the volunteer group did it, then we'll work to get it picked up. But if it's just somebody that just waited at the last minute, unfortunately, you know, we're not going to do that. I will give you, so just to put this into perspective, I text page this. So Samaritan's Purse has been, they're staging and they're being housed at one inside Baptist Church here in town, which is where I go to church. And so they got a big report yesterday morning. During Hurricane Adalia, they had 686 work orders. I mean, 686 people called them, and they went to their house and did work. So far already for Helene, they've had 2,030 work orders called in. You know, and that's just Samaritan's Purse. That's not everybody's not going to Samaritan's Purse. So, you know, the scale and the magnitude of this, is we thought Adalia was rough. You know, it took us a while. So that just hopefully set your expectations. You know, a year from now, probably 18 months from now, we're still going to be dealing with some of the effects. effects and working to clean up things.
Going back to the private park property issue,
mm-hmm.
and debris removal, somebody has a tree that's 2 feet off the right of way, and it's 3 or 4 feet in diameter hickory tree, and it falls in the road. Cut it off right at the right of way. How can we get that root ball picked up? How can we get that taken care of?
It's on private property, there's nothing.
I know, but the tree was on private property, but the tree itself fell on the highway.
So
we got that. So how do the people get rid of a root ball as big as a pickup truck?
The same way there. Yeah, I mean, unfortunately, if the tree had fallen the other way and it had been all in their yard, they'd be responsible for the whole tree. So
been on the house. Yes.
So
yeah.
So we if we go on private property, number one, it's illegal. But number two, we wouldn't get reimbursed for that. That would jeopardize, you do that one or two times, then that jeopardizes your funding for all the stuff you picked up correctly. So that's the main reason, So unfortunately it's not. Again, that's where the volunteer groups come in. If they can't hire a tree surgeon, some of the volunteer groups do have skid steers and things. So if the volunteer groups can get it, move that 3 or 4 feet into the right of way, then we can get it. But we can't go 2 feet on the private property.
So you'd have to hire somebody with an excavator or something to reach over and drag it so it's in the right of way.
Yes, sir.
And it's 2 feet.
Yeah.
Actually, I had a question. I guess time that you had paid to this, because I observed someone, private haulers, dumping it randomly on Cherry Creek in different areas of my district. And I just want to know, is there an estimate of how many citations that have been written or given out to those individuals doing things like that?
I can get that from code for enforcement. Permits, inspections, and code enforcement were outriding citations the day of the storm. So I can get that count from the industry.
The other thing I want you to know is in regards to the FEMA personnel locally, I spoke to a couple, but from what I'm hearing, a lot of the denials are coming from individuals who are not necessarily filling out paperwork correctly or making clerical errors and so forth. And how could they sit down with some of the FEMA personnel, or where are they located at?
They're located at the old church at 4434 North Forest Street Extension.
I've heard the same stories of folks make an application and in a really relatively short period of time they get a denial. Mm-hmm. But everything that I hear is, just then go to FEMA, go to over on Forest Street, sit down with those folks over there and basically work through the issue, and you probably will get a positive result.
So I would say that just about every application gets them out initially, either because of clerical errors, they check the wrong box, they put the wrong address in, something's not just quite right. The majority of them are denied because if you check that you have homeowners insurance, FEMA's not going to pay, and this is the same way for even the county expenses. FEMA won't pay until insurance. You can't double dip. So basically what the denial is, it said, okay, file a claim with your insurance, see what insurance is going to pay, and then once you get your letter from the insurance, how much they're going to pay, if they didn't cover it all, come back to us, and we'll talk about how we can cope the difference.
So citizens, I mean, it's difficult, and everybody's going through some challenging times, but you got to be very, very careful that you can't lean all on FEMA, because FEMA's not there to make you whole. The most money physical check that you can get out of FEMA is 0.25. That's if you totally lost everything and you have no insurance, nothing. 0.25 is all you're going to get. And then, as Ashley is saying, if you have insurance, then they'll pay a difference. They might pay you the difference in what your insurance pays and what your loss is, but they're not going to pay anything else.
So, and I've had to tell several friends this. So people, when they get the denial, they just get mad and they throw their hands up. And no doesn't necessarily So there's a process, and I think as taxpayers, we should appreciate, like, we don't want FEMA giving them a check, and they get the same check from their insurance, they get to pocket it. I mean, because this is our tax money, basically. So FEMA said there's a process. So the denial is, you know, hey, we just need a little more information. So if they'll go through the process and do the things that FEMA are asking them, then they have the opportunity. Now, that doesn't mean everybody, because just like anything else, you know, and I've cited examples after the storm, there are some people that just, hey, I want to apply. It's kind of like, hey, I'm gonna throw and see what sticks on the wall. You know, so they're just applying. So those people, when they get denied and they didn't really have any losses that they can, and again, you have to document it. You can't just say, hey, I lost everything. You know, unfortunately, FEMA doesn't pay. You know, we found this out during the Dahlia. You know, if your only loss is, hey, I was without power and lost every all the food in my refrigerator, then, you know, FEMA's not going to cover that. You know, there has to be some type of physical damage. You know, but there is this time the serious needs assistance, they call it. Everybody prefers the $750 checks. So if you can document, you know, basically if you can document that, hey, my power was out for more than 3 days, then you're most likely eligible for at least that immediate needs assistance, that $750. You know, and as far as the, you know, people that lost their food, you know, I know that for some people that is a true, you know, disaster expense. Paige has been working with Gail Finley, our local DFACS director. And so DFACS will be coming in the next couple of weeks. They're bringing in a huge army of people for Lowndes and all the surrounding counties. For they turned on the DSNAP benefits, the disaster, basically disaster food stamps. So, you know, somebody that was, you know, already receiving food stamps, they lost their food, they could get that, kind of get a little extra to help replace what they lost that way. So there are a lot of resources out there. You know, we're working to bring in as much as we can. Again, to the chairman's point, you know, we are doing everything that we know that's possible, but there's, you know, we're not gonna make everybody whole. So we're trying to help as many people as we can and get the good information out there. So that's really the biggest thing you do is you tell people that, hey, there's a process. You can go down to FEMA every day. You can go down to the Disaster Recovery Center every day. But when you go down there, somebody can pull it up and they can tell you exactly why. You know, like I said, it could be something, oh, there's a simple clerical error. They'll fix it right there and they're good to go. You know, so they can help them through the process.
Ashton, so the relationship or the agreement between FEMA and Lowndes County with the debris pickup, I've heard the city say that there's a 90-day period or something where it's 100% reimbursable.
So the president, in the initial declaration, he amended it and authorized 100% reimbursement for the first 90 days for category A and B. So that's going to be the debris and like all the response expenses that we had. And so that started September 24th. And so we've got until December 23rd. So everything's 100% until December 23rd. Now, GEMA has requested an extension. I'm not going to count my chickens. You know, I'm not going to put my eggs in that basket. The extension's going to be granted. But I have been talking with our hauler, and you know, kind of expressed to them, and their intent is they're doing everything they can to meet that 90 day. I mean, that's a monumental task, but they feel like they can do that for us. So,
but we weren't expecting that at all.
We were not
prior to this.
No, that is an extremely unusual. You know, I think it was a combination of the magnitude of the disaster combined with, let's be honest, it's an election year. You know, so that worked in our favor. So we don't care why they did it; just glad they did it.
So it's just it would be hard. hard to go back now and say, you know, hey, can you make it 120, you know?
Well,
I'm thinking about the tickets.
It wasn't, excuse me, but it wasn't a hard ask for me to do it. I went to the delegation, both our federal delegation and our state delegation, just as soon as we realized what the dates were, is that it was 90 days from start, and it has to be invoiced and completed in that 90-day period. It's not like you can start it anywhere in there and document it, and then it will carry on. That's not the way it has to be. The work has to be done, it has to be contracted, it has to be bid, it has to be contracted, and then it has to be completed and invoiced within that 90-day period.
Well, but I mean, unfortunately, we're relying on the fine folks at Samaritan's Purse who has, what did you say, 2,000 tickets already?
That's right.
They, you know.
So this is what I think would be a realistic expectation. Ashbrook, our contractor, they'll be done. Their goal is to be done within 90 days. Once they're done, there will be some of those Samaritan's Purse, you know, but fortunately, we've got 1.2 million, that's the estimate, is 1.2 million cubic yards of debris to pick up. If they get 1.2 million cubic yards picked up, Samaritan's Purse is probably less than 100, you know, I'd say it's probably less than 100,000. And we'll still get reimbursed. It just won't be the full 100%, it'll be 87.5%. But, and they may grant us the extension, but I think that if we can get the contract, you know, picked up, and then what we have to pick up with our own force account with Robbins personnel. And
we need to see if Public Works can work like the NASCAR guys.
They already have.
Keep in mind now that this is primarily what we're talking here is debris pickup.
That's right.
We still having a lot of structural damage on facilities that the county has and the cities has.
That's right.
That's going to have to be, number one, it's got to be engineered, it's got to be bid out, and that whole process, and that just can't get done in 90 days.
Well, and let me clarify, so that is not covered by the 100%. It's just the A and B. So,
okay.
So the damage to facilities and roads, and that's category C through G.
Okay.
So just A, so the debris is the big thing. But it wouldn't matter if we got it all done in 90 days, that damage,
okay,
would still be the cost share.
What is B then?
Category B is, they call it emergency protective measures. So that's like, if we bought equipment or maintenance equipment leading up to the disaster, we get reimbursed. I mean, we had, I don't know how many generators running, so we get so all of our equipment, fire trucks, Robbins trucks, food that we had to buy to feed workers.
We have to rent some additional heavy equipment.
So any of those expenses that we had that were directly related to our response. So again, the category A and B are your two biggest projects.
Well, that sounds a whole lot better than because if we get a commitment out of it. Aspirin, which I think is, they may have bit off more than they chew, but I was thinking we were going to see if we could pick it up debris after the first year.
Yeah. So we will, but hopefully it's just what Samaritan's Purse is pushing.
And Robin has gotten all of our dump trucks certified to be a part of the process, just like Aspirin. So we're always going to have some one-offs where right now we're dealing with one where a bunch of debris was piled behind someone's house, so the volunteers were getting it to the street so that we can get in and pick up. We can't always specifically schedule Ashford. They've got their routes, they're on their processes, but Public Works can go in and pick those things up. And so with the certification that Robin did as far as her team goes, we can go through the monitor and dump those loads just like Ashford can for reimbursement purposes. So Public Works is up and running. To your example, as far, we're pit crew, and it's as hard as they can.
And they're pit crew, but they can't do anything, you know, because what we're waiting on is the private property stuff to get moved. So it doesn't matter how fast Robin's crews work until somebody goes with private property and moves where we can pick it up. Not a whole lot we can do. I will take a minute. I think this is not going to come as a shock, but we get a lot of reimbursement that other counties, I mean, even FEMA, when they come in, they're like, why have we not seen, you know, we're not used to seeing this. So Robin's documentation is on point. so well, because she has gotten certified. We get reimbursed for, the, you know, all the debris that her crews pick up in addition to ash prep. We get reimbursed for that. We're one of the, we're one of the only counties I know of. Every time we have a disaster, we get reimbursed for grading and pulling every mile of ditch we have because of the maintenance schedule and the record keeping that she has. You know, most other counties, they go out, you know, during Adalia, the FEMA reps were telling them there were other counties that were trying to do that. They just didn't have the documentation, so they were having to deny it. So we receive a lot of funding that we would not ordinarily receive because of the work that her staff